Welcome to the Coming Out of the Dark Bible Study with Pastor John. Tonight's study will be in the book of Jeremiah. We invite you to join us at 1 Oakley Avenue in North Providence, Rhode Island. This podcast is presented to you by The Way Ministries, supported by listeners like you. For donations, live videos, podcasts, and more, please visit www.thewayministriesri.org. Thank you and have a great day.
Welcome to the Coming Out of the Dark Bible Study. I want to thank everyone for coming out tonight to get a portion of God's Word. Amen. First and foremost, let's thank our Lord and Savior Jesus. Give Him some glory tonight. Thank you, Jesus, for answered prayers, Lord. Thank you for loving us, Lord. Thank you for putting the right people back in office, Father. We're grateful for that. Thank you, Lord, for never leaving us nor forsaking us, Lord. I'm grateful. I'd like to thank the core of the ministry, One Body,
Many Parts.
If you have a cell phone, can you please silence it so it doesn't disturb tonight's service? And as always, we will start with a word of prayer. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for today. Lord, thank you for putting a godly man back in office, Lord, for our country, Lord. We're just so grateful and thankful, Lord, and excited, Lord, knowing that You're going to bring the principles of the Bible back to America, Lord, and make it great once again, Father, and heal our land, Lord. Help us to always be teachable and humble. Keep the government teachable and humble, Lord. Keep the Bible in all the churches as the owner's manual, Lord. I pray for unity in the churches now, Lord, as that we would wake up from our stupor and put the Bible back on the pulpits, Lord, as the ultimate authority, Lord. We're just thankful for the people here, Lord. We're thankful for the church you've given us. Thank you for your generous provisions that you provide for us each and every day, Lord. I'd like to say a prayer for our people that are not doing sick. Our sister Susan for her cancer. Mary, Donna's sister, for her cancer. Our brother Larry for his continued recovery. Chris for his continued recovery. Susan, which was the organ player for our church, let's pray for her breast cancer, and Alana and George, and Jean for cancer. Another prayer for Howie, right? And pray for Mary and Wayne. Dog Wilbur for his recovery. We're grateful for that because we're all God's children, and He creates the pets for us too, and they're like our family. So we pray for Wilbur that he gets better. And anyone else who might need a prayer, Lord, and I pray for our great nation, Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for putting somebody back in office that wants to do your will, Lord, not his. And we're grateful for that, Lord. And as always, let all this be led by your Spirit tonight and not my flesh. And it's in Jesus' mighty name that I pray. Amen and amen. All right, we're going to stand and worship the Lord. And we do have a birthday tonight. Ah, happy birthday, Brittany. You don't look a day over 20. No, you can't go that high. Okay. Control, no one knows. Getting past. together we're stronger, right? Okay, how's everybody doing tonight, all right? Good to see everybody, right? Got some good positive results. Hopefully turn our country around to where it needs to be. That's for sure. With the help of God, of course, and Jesus. All right, we're going to begin in 1 John chapter 5 tonight. As always, the Holy Spirit will be taking over as I go into these scriptures. So prepare your minds and your hearts to receive the message that the Spirit is trying to say to the church tonight. Amen? Amen. I also say a shout out to the live feed out there. If you want to worship with us tonight, you're welcome to. And if you consider this your church, if you consider donating to it and supporting it, so we can keep getting the message beyond the four walls and continue to rebuild their house and bring it back to its former glory. Amen. One body,
many parts.
Many parts. All together in the Spirit. So just a reminder, just somebody keep an ear out, just because maybe somebody's going to be coming later, if they can hear the bell. Is the bell on there? Okay, just keep the phone going, just in case. You never know. All right, 1 John chapter 5, she's got us in verse 13. Let's see if I want to stay in 13. All right. No. Go to verse 6. Okay. This is a good Trinity scripture right here. A lot of people say the Trinity's not in the Bible, but it is. I mention it right now. Verse 6 of 1 John chapter 5. And Jesus Christ was revealed as God's Son by his baptism in water and by shedding his blood on the cross. Not by water only, but by water and blood and the Spirit, who is truth, confirms it with his testimony. So we have these three witnesses: the Spirit, the water, and the blood. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all three agree. Since we believe human testimony, surely we can believe the greater testimony that comes from God. And God has testified about his Son. All who believe in the Son of God know in their hearts that this testimony is true. Those who don't believe this are actually calling God a liar because they don't believe what God has testified about his Son. And this is what God has testified. He has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have God's Son does not have life. I have written these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know you have eternal life. So he's trying to tell us, if you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, you have eternal life. If you don't, you do not. And we are confident that he hears us whenever we ask for anything that pleases him. Not us, pleases him. And since we know he hears us when we make our requests, we also know that he will give us what we ask for. See, when you're in God's will and you belong to Jesus, you ask for things that the Father wants. You're in his will. You ask God for God's will, not what you want. And that's why he answers. If you see a fellow believer sinning in a way that does not lead to death, you should pray. And God will give that person life. But there is a sin that leads to death. And I am not saying you should pray for those who commit it. All wicked actions are sin. But not every sin leads to death. We know that God's children do not make a practice of sinning. For God's Son holds them securely, and the evil one cannot touch them. You see what he's saying here? God's children don't make a practice of sinning. If we fall into sin is one thing, but we don't want to continue in it and make a practice of it. Can I get an amen? For God's Son holds them securely, and the evil one cannot touch them. We know that we are children of God and that the world around us, listen now, verse 19, listen what it really says here. We know that we are children of God and that the world around us is under the control of the evil one. Right now, this nation is supposed to be under God. But people are trying to get God out and letting the devil control the nation. That's why you see all these things that are sinful and getting accepted in society. Because it's now under the control of what? The evil one. And we know that the Son of God has come, and he has given us understanding so that we can know the true God. And now we live in fellowship with the true God because we live in fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the only true God, and he is eternal life. Dear children, keep away from anything that might take God's place in your hearts. We get saved, the Holy Spirit is in us, the Lord loves us, we want to follow him. But there are things that our flesh likes that can what? Take God's place in our hearts. The nation Israel was going to temple and worship on all the time. He says, you honor me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me. You know, you can come through a ritualistic, come to church saying, I'm doing a duty for God. But if your heart is not in the right condition, it's like you're wasting your time. That's what God's saying. Because God only hears people with the heart after God. Amen. We're here because we want to be here. And we have a desire to be here. We're not here because we're forced to be here. Can I get an amen here? Big difference. Big difference in the motive. It's all in the motivation of the heart. When you're one of God's children, you want to be here. You want to learn about him. You want to become like him. When you're not one of God's children, you reject and rebel everything that I'm talking about in the Bible. Because you don't want to hear that because you're under control of the devil instead. That's just a fact. When you want the devil, you don't want Jesus. When you want Jesus, you don't want the devil. Simple philosophy. Simple. All right, we're going to continue in Jeremiah chapter 13. We're starting a new chapter tonight, right? We ended chapter 12 last week. So we're going to begin Jeremiah chapter 13. I'm going to summarize it before we get started. Let me get a little turbocharged up here a little bit, you know. I was up till like 3 o'clock in the morning just listening and just because, you know, they were counting. And then all of a sudden my cable went out. So they said, oh, this is, you know, the devil doesn't want me to see the statistics, you know. But I still got it. I had it on my phone. I had my phone next to the bed. I kept falling asleep and waking up and hearing something, you know, hearing the electoral votes. And like, yeah. Finally, Lord. Something positive in my nation. For the past 4 years, the nations have been such a decline that sin has been running rampant in the nation and everybody's just obeying sin instead of God. And it's actually taking Christians away from the true faith because they're seeing that it's acceptable out there now. So they're saying, hey, can't beat them, join them. That's why we have to stay well rooted in the Bible so we can resist that. Because our flesh still likes sin. If it didn't, we wouldn't commit it. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is... Well, that's what we're here tonight to do. Strengthen the flesh. All right, let me summarize chapter 13, okay? Chapter 13, right? Huh?
You said strengthen the flesh.
Oh, we don't want to strengthen the flesh. The spirit, yeah, all right. Like I said, I went to bed at 3 o'clock in the morning. Give me a break. I'm falling asleep coming here. I got up this morning. I said, I felt like I didn't even go to bed. I was just tired, like drained. Because not only was I watching, but I was praying too. So when you're praying in the spirit and you're watching, it just beats you. It just wears you right out. All right. So how are the Judeans like dirty underwear? Listen now. This is what they're like. God tells Jeremiah to buy a linen loincloth and wear it, but tells him not to wash it. Then he tells Jeremiah to take the loincloth and hide it in a cleft in some rocks by the Euphrates River. After a while, God sends Jeremiah to get the loincloth, which is totally filthy and disgusting. God says that this is what happened to Judah and Jerusalem. They were originally supposed to be like God's own loincloth, cling to him in righteousness. But their disobedience has rendered them useless and ruined. This may be the only underwear analogy in the Hebrew Bible. We sure hope so, anyway. He gives Jeremiah another fun task, though. This time, he's supposed to tell the people that every wine jar should be full of wine. When they're like, yeah, tell us something we don't know, Jeremiah is to tell them that God's going to fill everyone in the land with the mad drunkenness and then smash them all together, parents and children, and there'll be no mercy. Again, Jeremiah begs the people to change their ways before it's too late. This is what we're trying to tell America, to change their ways before it's too late. This country was built on biblical principles. And this is why we're preaching this book. We're in this book for a reason. We're telling America right here, right now, to change its ways. Hopefully it will start to, now that we put somebody in office that wants to do things the right way and restore the laws of the land and hold people accountable for their behaviors and bring the law back to the law and enforce it when it needs to be enforced. This is what America, and this is what's happening. And if America doesn't, America, the same thing will happen to America that happened to them. Other countries will come in and what? World War III will start and they'll start taking over this country. And if God wants that to happen, there ain't no military that's going to stop it. And it's all, if you look what's going on in all these other countries, they're all starting to unite. Okay, North Korea, all these other countries starting to unite, Russia, China, and when they all unite, they'll have a lot of power. Yeah. So you see the stage is getting set. Okay? So, but there's always chance for what? Repentance and to turn it around. Okay. He says that he'll, listen, again, Jeremiah begs the people to change their ways before it's too late. He says that he'll secretly weep for them if they didn't repent. He sees all of Judah taken into exile and sees the crown of the king and the queen mother knocked off their heads. If the people ask why all these bad things are happening, they should know that it's punishment for their sins. Jeremiah compares what's happening to Judah to a rape. Jeremiah asks if Ethiopians can change the color of their skins or leopards change their spots. So that's where that expression comes from. They use it all the time, right? Even in society, right now, right? Obviously, the answer is no. And that applies to the evil Judeans, too. They're incapable of change. They're so deep into sin that they can't turn from it. This is what happens with sin. When you get so deep into sin, you can't turn from it. So that's why it says there's a sin unto death, because you can't turn from it and you'll die from it, with it. Jesus said you'll die in your sins if you don't repent. And there's always a sin that we have in us that trips us up all the time. And the Lord tells us to give it up, change. God says he'll scatter his people and publicly expose Judah to the world, lifting up its skirts for everyone to see. This chapter concludes with God saying that he's seen Jerusalem's adulteries and lust and wondering if it will ever make itself clean again. All right. Everybody in chapter 13? All right. Jeremiah's linen loincloth. This is what the Lord said to me. Go and buy a linen loincloth and put it on, but do not wash it. Okay. Now, let me just explain a little bit here. A linen loincloth was one of the more intimate pieces of clothing, okay? Clinging close to the body. It was similar to underwear, okay? Jeremiah's action showed how God would ruin Judah just as Jeremiah had ruined the linen loincloth. Verse 2. So I bought the loincloth as the Lord directed me, and I put it on. Then the Lord gave me another message. Take the linen loincloth you are wearing and go to the Euphrates River, or in the Hebrew, Parat. Hide it there in a hole in the rocks. Okay, so it's dirty underwear, so he goes and throw it in the hole in the rocks. Let it ferment for a little while in there. That's what he's saying. So I went and hid it by the Euphrates as the Lord had instructed me. A long time afterward, the Lord said to me, go back to the Euphrates and get the loincloth I told you to hide there. I went to the Euphrates and dug it out of the hole where I had hidden it. But now it was rotting and falling apart. The loincloth was good for nothing. Then I received this message from the Lord. This is what the Lord says. This shows how I will rot away the pride of Judah and Jerusalem. These wicked people refuse to listen to me. They stubbornly follow their own desires and worship other gods. Therefore, they will become like this loincloth, good for nothing. Now, I could throw America into this scripture. This is what the Lord says. This shows how I will rot away the pride of America. These wicked people refuse to listen to me. They stubbornly follow their own desires and worship other gods. Therefore, they will become like this loincloth, good for nothing. America is falling so far away from God right now, it's going to take a miracle to bring them back. Because they want God off out of the schools. They want prayers off the walls. They want you not to talk about God. They make things happen on Sunday so people don't come to church anymore. This is what's happening in our country right now, and it's set up by the evil one. And if we don't turn from it, we're going to have a lot of problems in this country, and we're glad that maybe now we have a shot of turning it around, because somebody that loves the Lord is getting in office. Thank you, Jesus. And they outwardly proclaim that, so... Okay. And verse 11. As a loincloth clings to a man's waist, so I created Judah and Israel to cling to me, says the Lord. They were to be my people, my pride, my glory, and honor to my name. But they would not listen to me. What do you think the slogan was all the time? In God we trust. God bless America. Why do you think that's in there? Because we were following God at one point. So God was blessing this country. Now listen. In verse 11, actions speak louder than words. Jeremiah often used vivid object lessons to arouse the people's curiosity and get his point across. See, this lesson of the linen loincloth illustrated Judah's destiny. Although the people had once been close to God, their pride had made them useless. The pride of America. Proud people may look important, but God says their pride makes them good for nothing. Completely useless. Pride rots our hearts until we lose our usefulness to God. What was the biggest sin in the Bible? Pride. And who was the one who committed it? The devil. He wanted to be just like God. He wanted to be God. I didn't want anybody to tell me what to do. I'm a God unto myself. And this is where America is right now. You see, if you go and interview people, who are you accountable to? Nobody. Myself. I don't have to follow any rules or anything, obey anything. The society is becoming lawless. People are not afraid to park under a no parking sign because they say, I'm not going to get a ticket anyway. People are not afraid to go through a red light because I'm not going to get a ticket. People are not afraid to talk back to the police because they don't think that they're going to do anything. Back in my day, you talk back to the cops, you get a smack. And there was no cameras. You got a wake-up call. You spent the night in the prison, in the cells, and this is what it's going to be like for you if you want to continue that way. So they try to scare you straight because they care about you. Now, it says the criminal has more rights than the police. That's how you know how wicked this nation's getting. That's why we got to keep praying. Now that something's happening, pray even more. Pray even more than now that it comes to pass. Because let me tell you something. Whenever a blessing comes, always be ready for what? A counterattack. And what? Opposition because of it. Believe me. Who knows? If they're going to what? Try to assassinate him or cause problems. But we pray that the Lord protects them. Because evil always wants to what? Snuff out righteousness. Bad is good. Good is bad right now in society. When people talk about doing the right thing, they call you like you're narrow-minded. You're not in the times anymore. This is 2024. Anything goes now. It's like, since when does that... When does anything ever... When did that change? Anything goes. People make their own laws, make their own rules. All right. Verse 12. So tell them, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. May all your jars be filled with wine. And they will reply, of course. Jars are made to be filled with wine. Then tell them, no, this is what the Lord means. I will fill everyone in this land with drunkenness. From the king sitting on David's throne to the priests and the prophets right down to the common people of Jerusalem. I will smash them against each other, even parents against children, says the Lord. I will not let my pity or mercy or compassion keep me from destroying them. Now, people can say, well, how can God be so cruel? How could God be so mean? No, God is not cruel and God is not mean. People are. God told them, gave them 40 years to turn from that and get back in line with God. And they simply said, no, don't waste your time. We're going to kill you. Don't teach us. We don't want to hear what God has to say anymore. They wanted all the prophets. They killed them all. They wanted them all dead. What do they want now? They want righteous churches dead. They want what? Denominationalism to rise, false gospels to rise, people to just come to church, get their worship, go back out, sin it up, and live like the devil. And that's just what the devil wants. And he wants to snuff out the righteous, saying, oh, you're legalistic. God, you know, all you got to do is believe it. You don't have to live right. And I don't know what Bible you're reading, but you live right because you do believe it. Because you want to live right, not because you have to. There's something inside you now that's changing your heart. Saying, I don't want to live like the devil anymore. Right. Although we might fight with it, we don't want to live that way anymore. And guess what? Church becomes a priority. The Bible becomes a priority. We don't put ourselves first anymore. No what? No hell or high water, sickness, illness, anything it is. I come here sometimes in so much pain, it does not matter. Because when I come here, he's the one who relieves my pain. Thank you, Jesus. Make no excuse, because he's the ultimate healer. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. In this verse from 14 we just read, Jeremiah used the picture of jars of wine to show how God planned to judge the people. Okay? This was the opposite of what would be expected by Jeremiah's audience, because full jars of wine were normally a sign of blessing. Remember the wedding at Cana? Jesus filled them up. Right? It was a blessing, a wedding. Instead, the full jars of wine represented the drunken confusion and the numbness of the people. Destruction would surely come, and the Lord was resolved to have no mercy on them. So, see, we have to understand, God's full of grace, God's full of love, and God's full of mercy, right? But there comes a day when that gets cut off, and he goes the other way with it. And he says, there's no chance for repentance now. Now it's time for judgment. And you can't say, oh no, Lord, give us the chance, we want to turn. I gave you 40 years to turn. And this is what it is. Today's the day of salvation. Christians think they can go on sinning and sinning and sinning because nothing's happening to them, and thinking that they're not going to get judged for it. Oh boy. You must be reading the wrong Bible. The Bible will keep you from sin, and sin will keep you from the Bible. You'll be tearing pages out of the Bible. That don't pertain to me. All right. A warning against pride. Verse 15. Listen and pay attention. Do not be arrogant, for the Lord has spoken. Now listen up what it says. Now, when is pride harmful? Listen to me now. When it causes us to, one, look down on others. Two, to be selfish with our resources. Three, to force our solutions on others' problems. Four, think God is blessing us because of our own merits. I'm getting blessed because I'm good. Five, be content with our plans rather than seeking God's plans. Right? I'm good. My plan's okay. I believe in Jesus, but my plan is what I'm doing. I'm filling my plan. Well, then you don't believe in Jesus then. Because his plan becomes your plan. That's right. All right, verse 16. All right. Give glory to the Lord your God before it's too late. America! Give glory to the Lord your God before it's too late. This message is going around the world right now. And it's not me talking. It's God speaking to America. It's God speaking to the world. God is speaking, give glory to the Lord your God before it's too late. Acknowledge him before he brings darkness upon you, causing you to stumble and fall on the darkening mountains. For then, when you look for light, you will find only terrible darkness and gloom. And if you still refuse to listen, I will weep alone because of your pride. My eyes will overflow with tears because the Lord's flock will be led away into exile. When God judges the nation, he judges the church first. Judgment starts in God's house. He says it right here. The Lord's flock will be led away into exile. Say to the king and his mother, come down from your thrones and sit in the dust, for your glorious crowns will soon be snatched from your heads. Now listen, we're going to talk about this in verse 18. The king was Jehoiachin, he's talking to here, okay? And his mother was Nehushta. Let me see if I can pronounce that better. Nehushta, that was her name, Nehushta. The king's father, Jehoiakim, had surrendered to Nebuchadnezzar, but later rebelled, okay? During Jehoiachin's reign, Nebuchadnezzar's armies besieged Jerusalem and both Jehoiachin and Nehushta surrendered. Jehoiachin was sent to Babylon and imprisoned. 2 Kings 24:1-5 tells us that. Jeremiah's prophecy came true. See? All right, verse 19. The towns of the Negev will close their gates, and no one will be able to open them. The people of Judah will be taken away as captives. All will be carried into exile. Now, verse 19 says, the Negev region is the dry wasteland stretching southward from Beersheba. The towns in this area will be closed to any refugees fleeing the invading army. Verse 20. Open your eyes and see the armies marching down from the north. The north. If you go all the way north, where do we hit? We hit China. Where is your flock, your beautiful flock that he gave you to care for? What will you say when the Lord takes the allies you have cultivated and appoints them as your rulers? Pangs of anguish will grip you like those of a woman in labor. You may ask yourself, why is all this happening to me? See, when something starts to happen to this country, you're going to ask, why is all this happening to us? And here's the answer. It is because of your many sins. It is because of your many sins. America doesn't have conviction of sin right now. People just sin and they want you to accept it and march with them over it and welcome it and actually what? Join it and rejoice in it. And I'm like, okay, tell me we're not in trouble. They're worshiping sin right now. And they're making a mockery of God's symbolism on top of it. So this is known. I was saying, that is why you have been stripped and raped by invading armies. Can an Ethiopian or a Cushite change the color of his skin? Can a leopard take away its spots? Neither can you start doing good, for you have always done evil. You see, once you start doing evil and continue in evil, you no longer can do good. Evil is your what? Best friend. Everything evil is good for you now. That's what happens. You get converted from good to evil. And that's all you do is evil. You are being controlled by who? Satan. And you don't even realize it. The Bible says, don't sin by letting anger control you. For anger gives a foothold to the devil. Now, is there anybody in here that gets angry? Oh, we're Christians. What happened? How come we get angry? We're all blessed by Jesus. What happened? Because we have a sin nature. That's what? Can still be controlled by the devil. If you let it. It says we get angry when things don't go our way. I'm so mad at you. You didn't let me have these sneakers. You didn't let me do this. You didn't do that. I can't believe it. You didn't give me that. Selfish. And sense of entitlement. The people in this nation. You brought me into this world. You got to take care of me. What happened in the Old Testament to the kids that disobeyed their parents? They got stoned to purge the evil from the nation. What are they doing now? The kids are stoning the parents. Why is that? Because the morality of the nation is decaying. Nobody has any morals anymore. So how? What are we? We have no standard to go by. Why do I got to obey my pastor? I don't have to do anything. Nobody's teaching me to do that. Nobody's punishing me for doing that. I'm not getting any consequences. So I can do whatever I want. How can you separate the morals of the Bible from the country? Because then you have a what? Lawless country. Everybody just does whatever they want in their own sight. No principles to follow. Come on, let's get real here. We need the principles of the Bible. Look what's happening to the country because of it. Look at the way people are today. So ignorant and rude and self-centered. My goodness. Everybody's in their own little box. It's all about me. Make me happy. Not thinking about, let me help someone out. Let me serve somebody. No, I want to get served. I'm the king of my castle. Serve me. We don't got time for church. We don't got time for Jesus. This is my world. And you say to yourself, well, how did you get here? Let's see. You were some little thing in the pond, about this big. And then you developed into a human being over time. That's what they teach. You were a polywog. You were a gorilla at one time. And then you lost all your hair, see? And now you, but why, that's why you like bananas. But when you need a heart valve, they get it out of the pig. Okay, so you tell me, if we're supposed to be like apes, why don't they get the heart valve out of the ape? They take it out of the pig. Why is the heart of a pig like our heart? Yes, you got it right. Here's the thing. They won't let you have a choice in school what to teach. They can't say, well, I choose creation. I choose there was intelligent design. I believe that God created all this. They don't even teach that. They teach we evolved from some pond scum from somewhere. And we just exploded into existence. You didn't know that? Boom, here it is. Let me tell you something. When the planes flew into the Twin Towers, the two new ones come up beside it? No, when there's an explosion, it destroys. It doesn't create. Doesn't even make any sense. No, you know how we know it makes sense? The Lord spoke this into existence. And here you are. The Creator wants to bless you. Who created you wants you to what? Worship and honor him. Because if it wasn't for him, you wouldn't be here. But no, I was a polywog. And here I am today. Zillions of years of evolution. Well, how come how come I'm not changing into something else by now? How come we're not evolving into something else? Ridiculous. And then they poison the kids' minds with all this stuff. That this is how you got here. There's no such thing as Jesus. That's just the story. There's no church. You don't need that. There's a church on every corner, but I don't know why they're there. And you wonder why God judges. And God says, I'm telling you how you got here. I'm showing you a way to live. I'm showing you how to have a good life down here. But you want it your way. So we're what? Self-destructive in our nature. No. So it says, for you've always done evil. Now in verse 23, not even the threat of captivity could move the people to repent. Listen, God said, he's telling them God's judgment's coming. You're going to go into captivity. You're going to get judged and you're going to get punished from another nation. They're going to hold you in exile. It didn't move the people to repent at all. That's how deep into sin they were. The people had become so accustomed to doing evil that they had lost their ability to change. Okay? God never rejects those who sincerely turn to Him. God was warning His people to repent before it became impossible to change. We must never put off until tomorrow changes God wants us to make. Our attitudes and patterns for living can become so set that we lose all desire to change and then no longer fear the consequences of remaining as we are. What's the evidence of salvation? A changed life. You come as you are, but you never stay as you are. Verse 24. I will scatter you like chaff that is blown away by the desert winds. This is your allotment, the portion I have assigned to you, says the Lord. For you have forgotten me, putting your trust in false gods. America has forgotten God. Has no fear of God. No fear of God. Verse 26. I myself will strip you and expose you to shame. I have seen your adultery and lust, and your disgusting idol worship out in the fields and on the hills. What sorrow awaits you, Jerusalem? Or America. How long before you are pure? So what are they doing? Idol worship out in the fields and the hills. What are people now celebrating? Pride week. They're up celebrating that we're like this now. And we went. And what's the difference of what they were doing that we're doing right now? Celebrating sin. And thinking that nothing's going to happen because of it. No. This nation is in big trouble. They're celebrating sin and worshiping sin like it's nothing. All we can do is what? Pray. Why do I pray for the nation? Because a nation is infected with what? Evil spirits that enter into people. When God's spirit leaves, what comes in? Evil spirits. Seven times worse than the ones that were here before. We're giving people more lustful desires and more, what, twisted perversion thinking to do things that are like so disgusting, so vile, and they get pleasure out of it. And people suffer, and people die, and families disintegrate because of it. And yet people are clapping and saying, yeah, we want more. I want you to accept that. And when it's destroying every, it's destroying the fabric of our nation. And the only thing that's going to turn it around is Jesus. People can't fix people. Sinners can't fix sinners. That's why we're here. We're here to let Jesus fix us and make new creatures out of us. But one thing that has to go, the old life has to go. You can't have both. You'll love one or hate the other. And some of us had enough of that. Every time the doors of the church are open, I'm here. When I see what's going on, when you understand that what you see out there is not the reality. What you see in the Word is the reality. So it's a spiritual thing in nature. So that's why somebody that doesn't have the Spirit can't see it. Right? They can't see the devil working behind the scenes. They blame it on people, places, and things. They don't see demons. They don't know the demons. They don't see them. But they're just as real as the day is long. And they enter your mind. How do I know? You tell me when you're praying and something enters your mind so vile and vulgar, and where did it come from? Where did these thoughts come from? Why do you well up with anger all the time when you don't get it? Where do you think it comes from? They're not emotions, they're spirits that enter into the human mind and cause what? Problems. Disobedience, rebellion, what? Anger, resentment, gossip, slander. People can't wait to degrade other people and talk about other people and run other people down. What do you think enters your mind? It's a spirit that makes you do that. That tempts you to exalt yourself and degrade someone else so you feel better about you. And then you get the Holy Spirit, right? That comes into you. We don't want that spirit. That's boring, that spirit. See, the Holy Spirit gives us contentment. See, the world spirit gives us what? Insatiable appetites. You want one, you want another one. You want two, you want three. You want this one, you want the next best one. It brings no contentment. And it makes us what? Crave things that are harmful. They kill us. And the Holy Spirit just brings us what? Peace. People think they're going to get peace out of what? Material things. All it does is bring problems and responsibilities. And it takes you away from the Word of God. Because now you're going to take care of all that stuff and pay for it. I digress. So I thank Jesus for putting someone in the office that cares about the people more than about their pocket. Amen? All right. So we're going to continue when we get to chapter 14. When we come back together, we just finished chapter 13. Drew, you want to come up and close us?
Let's bow our head. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this message, Lord. Thank you for being with us, Lord. Thank you for having mercy on us, Lord. I thank you for this time, Lord, to regroup and gather, Lord. Please let your Holy Spirit get into the minds of believers and unbelievers, Lord, and just turn us towards you in this country, Lord. I just pray that, Lord, we put you first in all things, Lord, so we can be blessed once again, Lord. And I just pray, Lord, that you speak to our hearts. Let us have open minds and come humbly before you so we can be teachable, Lord, and we can understand your ways, Lord. And help us to be loving and compassionate with people that don't understand, Lord. And I just pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right, thanks, Drew. All right, we're going to watch a video and we're going to close.